We enter now into the deadly poppy field. Poppy fields are beautiful and inviting, but just like in Oz, they can be dangerous. I fell into them with the update statement in SQL Server. The ANSI SQL standard allows for just three clauses in the update statement: update, set, and where. And if you need to update one table with values from another, you can use a subquery in the set clause. Generally, when your update is based on primary keys, there's not much danger, but often external data is used to update columns. Let's look at an example. Here's a table of movies identified by a surrogate primary key, the ID column. We also have columns for title, country, and year released, and notice there are some foreign films in the table. There's also information about US movies in a CSV file that I've brought into the database as a table. And what I want to do is alter the movies table, add a duration column, and update it with running time from the CSV file. The problem is that the CSV file is ignorant of my primary key, so I'm going to have to be extra careful in the update. After all, just like a join and a select, we have the same issues with nulls and duplicates. Let's see how this update statement might be written in Oracle and DB2. I'm using a correlated subquery to set duration equal to the running time in US Movie Info where the titles match in both tables. It looks reasonable until you consider that the instruction to the DBMS is saying update movies. And without a where clause, it's going to update every single row in the movies table. What about movies in our database that aren't in the US Movies CSV file? I have foreign films in the movies table. What will happen to them? Well, if they aren't found in US Movie Info, the column will be updated with null. So let's put a where clause to check that the title exists in both tables before updating. Alternatively, we can check to see that the title is in US Movie Info. SQL Server allows an update based on a join. Notice that this automatically limits the update to titles that exist in both tables. This statement, short and simple, accomplishes the same thing as the query written for Oracle. It's beautiful, like a poppy field. The danger lies in what happens when join conditions are wrong. Note that we've joined our tables on title alone. We haven't considered remakes. So it's possible that we'll have two Wizard of Oz movies in our movies database, but only one in the CSV file. And in fact, we have the classic 1939 Judy Garland Wizard of Oz movie, as well as a Canadian short film, only 9 minutes long, by the same name. So what will happen when we update based on title alone? Let's run a select statement to see what will happen. Regardless of whether we use Oracle syntax or an update based on a join, both movies in our movies table will be updated with the running time of the one in the CSV file, 101 minutes. Our data quality suffers, but the error is ours alone. The DBMS is doing only what we asked it to do, updating based on title alone. And title isn't enough to guarantee uniqueness. Let's look at another situation. What if there are two movies in the US Movie Info table for The Wizard of Oz, but only one in our movies table? What will happen then? Again, let's run a select statement to see the result. We see our one movie, the 1939 Judy Garland classic, being updated by two rows from US Movie Info. The 1939 movie at 101 minutes and another one made in 1925 that was only 93 minutes long. If we update based on a subquery, the DBMS will see that two rows are returned and it will not allow the update. We'll get an error. If we update based on a join, SQL Server won't say anything at all. The statement will succeed and one of the two rows will update the duration column. Will it be 101 or 93? We don't know. And that's why this is the deadly poppy field. You don't even realize the danger. So the question you've got to ask yourself is, do I feel lucky? Well, do you? Or do you know Glinda? Glinda is the good witch of Merge. Merge is typically used when you want to update a row if it exists and insert it if it doesn't. It's sometimes referred to as an upsert. You'll notice that we're updating this time based on values in US Movie Info that match on all the columns that form the true key, country, title, and year released. When there's a match, the value is updated, and when there isn't a match, the row from US Movies Info is inserted. Although this is the typical use of merge, you don't have to have both when clauses. Only one when clause is required, so it's perfectly acceptable to use merge for update. And the benefit of doing so is that SQL Server will give you an error, a nice long descriptive one, and you'll know to check your join conditions if two rows are returned to update one. When you're updating on something other than the primary key, this can be a safe option. You'll sometimes hear warnings about merge in SQL Server being buggy or tricky or unnecessary. I've even met someone who said, "I don't allow my developers to use merge." If that's the case, keep in mind that the ANSI standard update works in SQL Server, and it will give you an error if two rows are returned to update one. In this presentation, I've covered some of the differences in DBMSs in their default configurations. The Munchkins, the Wicked Witch and the Flying Monkeys, and the Deadly Poppy Field. In conclusion, although it's absolutely true that what you learn on SQL can be applied to all databases, there are tons of differences that go much further than the obvious differences in dialect and sometimes require different ways of approaching problems. Before you go, be sure to take the Ruby slippers with you. The Ruby slippers of knowledge that DBMSs differ in many ways. With that awareness that the differences extend beyond syntax, you'll be able to go over the rainbow, to grow your skills to work on multiple DBMSs, and become wizards of SQL.